For kart racing, parity exists on the driver's side this year.
In the front, we got the players' guys who aren't exactly fast friends, but up front, I think it's...
But Chevy's domination ended 2 weeks ago when Bobby Rahal was the winner. Come on, you. First win and the first for the Judd-powered Lola.
In autumn, sports often include a homecoming, and this weekend is precisely that for Bobby Rahal. He returns to the Mid-Ohio racetrack owned by his team, and coupling the Pocono win with an intimate knowledge of Mid-Ohio that puts Rahal equally at ease in the dry or the wet, marks him as a favorite for today. The challengers are these men. But the hunted is Bobby Rahal as he attempts to add a Mid-Ohio victory to an unprecedented third consecutive national championship run. ESPN, the world leader in motorsports, presents Speed World. We are in Lexington, Ohio, some 60 miles north of Columbus, for the 11th round of the CART PPG IndyCar World Championship. It's the 9th annual Escort Radar 200. And it's brought to you by Dodge Cars and Trucks. When it's gotta be right, it's gotta be a Dodge. By Quaker State Motor Oil, the big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will. By Champion Premium Air and Oil Filters, the filter line with the highest standards in the world. And by Budweiser, proud sponsor of the 1988 U.S. Olympic team. This Bud's for you. Well, after a parched summer in the Midwest, Mother Nature has decided to kick off the fall season with intermittent inclement weather. Hello, everyone. I'm Jack Arute, and we're here at Mid-Ohio with our annual Labor Day rendition of the Radar Escort Warning Detector 200. And the man that won the first race here, the first IndyCar race in 1980, is working with us in the booth. Johnny Rutherford. Johnny, for somebody like Bobby Rahal, hot off a top victory in Pocono, coming back to his home track, how important are those psychological factors?
Oh, it's the greatest thing in the world. Confidence is the greatest thing in the world at this point for Bobby Rahal, and of course, it's what makes it tough for the competitors to beat him. He has the confidence, he has the role, he won the major race at the 500 in Pocono, coming to his backyard, as it were, his home racetrack. He's probably got as many miles as anybody here, so I'm sure that confidence level in trying to keep the lead in the points race is going to mean a great deal to him.
Well, it may indeed also have a threat with weather, and as far as Bobby Rahal is concerned, that could stand in good stead as he tries for another victory here at Mid-Ohio's hometown track. And he's standing by with Larry Neubert. Let's go to Larry.
Regardless of any weather factors, whenever you come to Ohio, the most significant factor is the man on my left, your right, Bobby Rahal. In 5 years, he's never finished lower than third. You're on a roll, you won Pocono, piece of cake today, eh?
Well, I think the weather's going to be the deciding factor today. The car's going very, very well. We're third on the grid. I like the track, but the weather definitely is going to be the factor. Who gets lucky with it and who's got the right setup? It's anybody's guess whether it's going to be wet, dry, or in between, or what have you. So probably it'll be a combination of all three. So that's going to be the big factor today.
Bobby, you have been on Mid-Ohio perhaps more than any other IndyCar driver in today's field. Does this place get super slippery when it's just a little wet?
Very, very slick. In fact, it's usually a little bit better when it's wetter than it is when it's just damp. But, this is really going to... It's too bad because the race in the rain, although it's part of road racing, I'm never sure if it's good for the crowd. And, it certainly isn't a lot of fun to drive in the rain, but what you get is what you get.
Well, in years past, it's been Rahal against the field, and Gary Lee will talk about that.
Well, one of the members of the field that will be contending for the championship today will be the driver of this car, the Craco number 18, Michael Andretti. Now, when we talk about emotions within the stable of Bobby Rahal, the True Sports team, we have to mention once again it was announced, surprisingly so this week, that Bobby will join this team next year. He will drive for Craco and Maury Cranes. Now, the question now being, where will Michael Andretti go? For the past two seasons, Michael has talked about his desire to run Formula One. But more recently, we've heard the story that Michael might join his dad, Mario, with a second car with Newman Haas. Most top-line drivers don't like to have a teammate, but Mario would love to have Michael. So the question now be, who's going to take the vacant seat with True Sports? Will a two-time world driving champion Emerson Fittipaldi leave Patrick to go over there? There's another good bet that Jeff Brabham, having a great year in IMSA, will return to IndyCar competition. But remember, we can speculate all day, but all the pieces will fit together sometime in the next few weeks. So right now, we've got a race to run, Jack.
Well, thank you, Larry and Gary, and we'll be back just momentarily to take a look not only at this course, but also the starting grid for this weekend's Radar Escort Warning Detector 200. Don't go away.
No matter how Dodge makes it look, winning ain't easy.
Off the road, the land is mean. The ultimate test of man and machine. So we take on the dust, we take on the heat. Just trying to prove that Dodge can't be beat.
And if winning was easy, why run the race? Can't be number one if you don't set the pace. At Dodge, we know there's only one first place. If winning was easy, it wouldn't be a race.
If you're looking for winning performance, it's gotta be a Dodge.
Ricky Rudd talks about Quaker State with QSX.
If you're like me, you want your engine to perform. You want it to run clean, and you don't want sludge. That's why you and I both need Quaker State with QSX.
QSX keeps dirt particles in suspension, so they're trapped in your oil filter instead of sludging up your engine.
No other oil runs cleaner or fights sludge better. And the Quaker State I use in my car is the same oil you can buy right off the shelf for your car.
Quaker State, the big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
It's America's fastest production car, the Callaway Corvette. To create a Callaway Corvette, the entire engine must be built by hand. Nearly 1,500 parts are redesigned or modified. What's one of the few parts that isn't redesigned or modified? A Champion Premium Filter, which is already engineered to meet the most demanding specifications. Champion Oil and Air Filters, the filter line with the highest standards in the world.
At participating Sears Coast to Coast, Myers Western Auto Stores, or call the connection.
Come on, get going. Breakfast is ready at Burger King. We'll make a fresh croissant sandwich or bagel sandwich just for you.
We do it like you would do it when we do it like we do it at Burger King.
Welcome back to Lexington, Ohio and the Mid-Ohio Racecourse, and let's give you a quick look at the specifics of this racing facility. 2.4 miles in length, 15 turns, and that's a gutbuster. 9 right and 6 left. And one of the things that makes it so difficult to get around here is 30 to 51 feet is an awful narrow width for road racing. 20 to 25 gear shifts per lap. The race will be 84 laps, and we should expect pit stops around lap 28 to 30. Now, Johnny Rutherford, let's take a look at the facility itself and how best to get around it.
Yes, well, you obviously leave from the start-finish line on the front straightaway, heading through turn number one under the bridge. It's a hard left-hander, very fast with an Indy car. Through there in probably third gear, shifting to fourth and fifth, heading on down toward the kink and the keyhole. The kink is where you go through a series of right and left-hand up around a 180-degree turn that is almost off camber. It feels like it goes the wrong way. Down the 3,100-foot back straightaway, has a slight dogleg to the right in it. It's very fast, flat out down through there to what they call madness. The turn at the end of the back straightaway, around that turn, and then you come up over a blind brow curve and head up through a series of kinks, another over the hill, the car gets light, down to the back straightaway where you turn through there, down this back straightaway. It is a downhill under the bridge and a slight right-hander, and then back to the left, a kink back to the left. It's very fast through this section of the course, down to the carousel. Turn number 14 around the carousel, which also appears in the from the race car to be a little off camber. A short straightaway, then back out onto the front straightaway, and you've completed a lap at Mid-Ohio.
Certainly one of the more interesting road racing facilities we run on, but one of the most interesting new parts of this track actually isn't part of the course itself. In fact, it's a way to get off the course. And for more on that, let's check in with Gary Lee.
Well, Jack, the owner of this racetrack, the Truman family, has always been safety conscious. And to that end, they've made some great improvements to the pit area. The pit now has been widened by 10 feet. It's been lengthened by over 150 feet to encompass 10 new pit areas. However, we have a very safe area for those that will be working the signal boards. In fact, the pit crew guys down here are sequestered between this concrete wall and this guardrail. They can really work the pit board without worrying about turning their back to the race cars. But to enter the pit area, the drivers have to come off turn 14. Now, as Johnny Rutherford says, as the track gets wetter, the groove gets wider. So in the area where the drivers are slowing down to enter the pit area is the same area where the fast cars are negotiating turn 14. That could be a problem. Also, the drivers have to use their head and think as they come in. If they come in too fast, too hot, they can get off the track, off the surface to the grass, and right to the guardrail. That could be a concern this afternoon. We'll keep an eye on it.
Thank you, Gary. And we'll be back with the Escort Radar Warning 200 in a moment.
only Auto Week, the news weekly of motoring, makes cars come alive every week. GTs, sports sedans, collector cars, 4x4s, front drivers. And Auto Week makes racing come alive every week. Formula One, sports cars, stockers. Auto Week brings it home fast, days after the race. Auto Week makes you an insider with industry news, personality profiles, columnists, the best classified anywhere. Let Auto Week, the news weekly of motoring, make cars come alive for you. Call 1-800-554-3000 to get Auto Week at our special discount price. Just $17.25 for 52 issues, only 33 cents a week. You'll save 74% off the cover price, 25% off the basic rate. Call now, 1-800-554-3000. Let Auto Week make cars come alive for you every week.
Are you still using this kind of drill? Then why use this kind of screwdriver? Now there's Torque.
Take a look at the starting lineup for today's Escort Radar Warning 200 here at Mid-Ohio. On the pole is Danny Sullivan with an average speed of 112.766 miles per hour in the Miller PC17. Flanking him on the outside is Ellinger Jr., 112.720 for the team Valvoline March 88C.
Starting in the second row on the inside is Bobby Rahal of Dublin, Ohio, with a speed of 111.914. Starting outside in the second row is the man that holds all the statistics records in road racing for CART, Mario Andretti from Nazareth, Pennsylvania, at a speed of 111.661.
The man that won the Indianapolis 500 in 1988 flanks inside of row number three, 111.339 miles per hour for the Penske Pennzoil Special of Rick Mears. Emerson Fittipaldi flanks him on the outside at 111.173 in the Marlboro McLaren Lola.
Starting in seventh is Michael Andretti, and outside of that row is Scott Pruitt. In the fifth row, Deddy Ateys. There's some of the other starters here. A.J. Foyt getting a good start here. John Jones, Guerrero, Lion Dyke back after that accident. Rocky Moran, Howdy Holmes in row 9. Darren Brasfield, a newcomer, starts in row 10. Fulvio Balbio and Tony Bettenhausen. Ed Pym is back in row 12. And Raul Boisel will start in 13th position as we get a green flag here. And that's an unusual start, Johnny, because they do it midway down the backstretch. Yes, they move the start-finish line from in front of the pits over there for a cleaner start. It's a little more wide open. You have the long straightaway to contend with. Here we see the cars coming over that blind brow, a little bit close there for Emerson Fittipaldi and Rick Mears. So it's close racing. And right now the racetrack is in between. It's not quite wet and it's not quite dry. And we heard Bobby Rahal allude to that fact that that's when it's probably the most dangerous.
But CART's chief steward, Wally Dallenbach, elected a wet start. That means all these cars are using the rain tires, but we could see them pit early to go to dry tires. Your leader is Danny Sullivan. Rahal is in second. Directly behind Rahal in the white car and challenging is Mario Andretti. Andretti takes a peek to the inside, and it looks like there's a slight advantage, at least at the present, Johnny, for Danny Sullivan, but it tends to go away as we get ready to come to the carousel portion of this racetrack. Rahal is beginning to close just a tad.
Well, this is that point where it's very slippery out there, and the guys with cold tires, cold shocks, the cars ride a little bit rough. You've got to take it a little bit easy. We have a spin.
Dale Bobby has spun in turn number 14. Bobby, as you can see, is resting almost in front of the entrance to pit road. The Quaker State Porsche is still running. He pulls back out on the racetrack. And in the interim, while that spin was going on, back up front, it was Mario Andretti taking over second position. Now Andretti has taken up the challenge for the lead, held by Danny Sullivan. Sullivan rounding out of the keyhole and heading down the 3,100-foot back straightaway here in Mid-Ohio.
Mario is very, very good in the wet. In fact, he's probably considered to be one of the best IndyCar drivers in the wet. He has turned laps nearly as fast on some tracks in the wet as he did in the dry. There he is, going for the pass, and he makes it.
A real nice move, and he almost loses it. He had to carry it in a lot deeper than he cared to.
There's that slick part of the racetrack. The groove where you would normally run when it's dry is very slippery, and because the tires have polished the pavement, you have to move outside. You saw him slide through that slick part, push the front end, get out into that sandpapery edge, you would like to call it, where he can get some traction, and that's where you've got to run. You'll see them as long long as it's a little damp, running a little bit wider in some of the areas.
Well, there was some calculated risk-taking early on in this race, and I almost kind of wonder if that was really the wise thing to do. But let's go back and look at the pass one more time. And Johnny, it looks as if he went in a little deeper, as we said, and almost lost it.
He just flat out braked Danny Sullivan in the corner. There you see the front end push. It went straight for a little bit. He was heading for that outside part so he could get some traction.
Well, Sterling Moss once said you only race hard enough to win. And for Mario Andretti, that's always been his technique. But it's kind of interesting to me to see him challenge this early. Could it be that he's trying to pad his lead to come in for dry tires?
I think so. That's obviously the strategy at this point. He wants to take advantage of the way his car is working, which is obviously very good. He is there. You saw a tear-off lens come off of his helmet. He pulled it off so he'd have a clear vision and be able. He's out front now. No more spray. He got rid of that. He's opening up a lead.
Now, in the interim, as Andretti continues to lead as he rounds out of the keyhole, look at this battle. Bobby Rahal has gotten by Danny Sullivan, and directly behind Sullivan is Al Unser Jr. and Emerson Fittipaldi and Michael Andretti. A gaggle of cars there as they head down the backstretch.
Oh, that is a real race right there.
Now, how difficult is it to be in the front of that sort of heat going down 3,100 feet of asphalt here at Mid-Ohio, Johnny?
Well, I can tell you what, being back in it is the difficult part because you get a lot of spray on your... Oh, we've got a spin! Danny Sullivan spins! Al Unser Jr., Michael Andretti is off of the racetrack.
Now, remember, this could cause problems for all these cars, not necessarily bending the cars up, but because of the wet we've had all weekend, it is very slick out there, and Andretti seems to be doing the best getting back out.
Yes, he made it back all the way across that long expanse of grass, and he's back on the race course, getting his tires clean so he can do a little catching up.
So,
that was incredible. That was the point where they all start racing one another, and it is very slippery out there at this point.
Let's look again as they came hurtling down into the turn for madness, and here's exactly why they call it madness.
Yeah, there you can see Sullivan locked up his brakes and spun the car. Little Al Unser spun to the inside and came back, was able to save it. Michael Andretti off in the grass, and Danny Sullivan looks like he still saved his and his motoring.
Well, everybody managed to keep their poise about them and get back out on the racetrack. And there we see Al Unser Jr. and Derek Daly, along with Rick Mears. The Penske's are continuing to run here very well. Mears now being shown in the sixth position as Michael is held down, and he is being shown in seventh. So thus far, even though it's the early going, I'm a little bit surprised at just how tough these guys are racing each other.
Yeah, you know, they will. And I think let's go down to the pits to Gary Lee. He has some information on the track conditions.
Well, first we check with Steve Horn with True Sports. He said Bobby called in on the radio, said the track is drying out very rapidly. He would have to stop within 10 laps to take on the dry, slick pavement tires. However, in talking with the Andretti crew, it is really the call of the driver. Now, Johnny Rutherford, as the track dries out, I would think if the track is just a little damp, it might be better for them to go to the slicks, correct?
Well, some guys can handle that. I personally can't. It's a situation where I like the dries until it gets a little bit drier. But it's, I think we're going to have the, here we'll take a look at the spin from the in-car camera.
The Valvoline in-car camera in Al Unser Jr.'s car, and you can see he really is right in the middle of the fracas as they get ready to head down into madness. That right-hander, let's just take a look at what happens here. Everything looks okay thus far.
At this point, you can see the contrails, vapor trails off of Sullivan's wings. That's a phenomenon that happens there. They're into a wet part. You can see how the vision of the driver gets obscured, and here we see Little Al going to the inside to try to make a pass, to outbrake Sullivan into the corner. And suddenly he's sideways. Obviously they came together. He's gone part of the way around. The car catches the back end, gets traction, and he's able to bring the front end back around. That is incredible footage.
The incredible thing was taking a look at how he had enough poise to check his mirrors while he's doing almost a 180 there inside the race car. I'll tell you what, I don't know how you guys do it. I'm happier being in the booth or in the pits. So we're back with Mario Andretti leading this event. Emerson Fittipaldi is running second. Bobby Rahal is third. And despite the spin, Al Unser Jr. is running in the fourth spot. So thus far, it is Mario Andretti who has streaked to a sizable advantage as you look at Andretti going down into what they call madness. They're actually turns 6, 7, and 8 here at Mid-Ohio. We'll be back with more from the Escort 200 after this. Don't go away.
Well, a number of reports, of course, are coming in from the drivers in the cockpit. I'm standing by with Chuck Sprague about the incident involving Danny and Little Al. What were her comments?
Danny just said that Little Loud punted him up the back and knocked him off, that he just wanted to check over when he came by. Everything looks okay from our viewpoint. It's knocked Little Al's front wings off, so it looks like he's gotten the short end of the stick long term. At the moment, we're down at 14th trying to claw our way back up.
What are his comments about track conditions? Is it very slippery or just slippery in spots?
I think he's a little too busy to give us any comments because he hasn't said much besides that one report.
Well, Danny Sullivan, who started on the front row, really has his work cut out for him before this first round of pit stops. And unlike stock cars in the South, Jack and Johnny, there are no caution flags to help you out. You got to drive through it.
Well, that's a very good point, Larry. And in fact, as we look for a pass here for the lead, Emerson Fittipaldi again, just carrying it in way deep for Mario Andretti as they go to madness. Battles on the high side, but Fittipaldi takes the lead.
There's two world champions right there, Mario Andretti and Emerson Fittipaldi, both with a great deal of Formula One experience and racing in this type of weather condition. Emerson obviously has got the better car at this point and has gone for the lead and taken it.
We speculated before the last commercial break that Andretti might have been trying to build up a sizable lead so that he could come in and take on dry tires as this track continued to dry out. It may be the situation occur that they saw those people doing that, and the crew for Emerson Fittipaldi's team said, hey, turn the wick up and start to take the lead and try to do the same thing. We'll talk about that in a minute. Let's check in with Gary Lee, though. Maybe he can shed some light on that matter.
Well, the two drivers that are battling for the lead right now both have private pilots, and they're having their pilots every few minutes check with the Weather Bureau. They say there's more rain coming in, so right now the strategy is, despite the fact the track is drying out, it might be advantageous right now to stop for the pavement tires. They're staying out there with the Gatorback rain tires because both pilots say more rain is coming. So roll the dice right now.
Rutherford, when you started racing, I think all you needed was a mechanic with a toolbox. Now we've got to have engineers, we've got to have pilots, we've got to have all this extra stuff. And look, Michael Andretti is in the pits. Michael Andretti in the pits. They're exchanging the tires, and obviously that's got to be a result of the spin, and we have a report, too, that he has a problem with the front wing.
Yes, it looks like he's going to the dries, and that will be interesting now to see if we do get any more weather. If we do, then he's got a serious problem because he'll have to come back in and put on a fresh set of rain tires.
Is this a gamble now on their part to be the first to go to the dry tires?
Well, it could be, but then again, it could be one of the smartest moves. You know, if it stays dry, then these other guys are going to have to come in, and he will already be on the dries, and he can stay out there and cruise on. So that's we'll have to watch and see.
Now, you can see as you watch the two leaders circumnavigate this racetrack, actually what we like to call the back 40, as they prepare to come up to turns 4, 13, 14, and 15, the carousel. The track is beginning to show those dry marks. You can see the contrast in the color, and that will heat up those rain tires in a very quick manner.
It'll
tear them apart.
Yes, it will. It will shred them and cause them to blister in the meaty part of the tire. So I don't think it's quite. You'll see Emerson, he's very good in the rain as well as Mario, and you'll see them hunting out the wet spots. If there are any puddles or any places where they can run to cool those tires down, you'll see them doing it. And it's a situation where they're both know what they're doing. I think we want to go to Larry Newber down in the pits. He has some information for us.
Johnny, there's a lot of work going on down here in the Al Unser Jr. pit. As you can see, the cars come in. They've already changed the four tires, gone from the Gatorback rain design to the slick tires for dry pavement. That's not their biggest problem. As reported earlier, the wings up front were heavily damaged in that shot with Danny Sullivan. They've had to change the supports and the very basic structure of the front wings in order to put the new ones on. There's a lot of grass and mud that's on the underside of the car, both of the side pods, on the front and the back, as well as the nose piece. And to clean out, extensive amount of work going on underneath the Al Unser Jr.
Now, Al Unser Jr. needed a good finish here to really stay in the hunt for the points chase. He admitted that, said he had to, as we look from the driver's perspective. And that's difficult, Johnny, to sit there and know that somebody's working at your car and costing you valuable time.
It really is. It's exasperating for you because you're very competitive at this point, and you know what it's going to take for you to maintain or to pick your way back up. So he is back out on the track now. He has a fresh set of front wings. If everything is in good shape, then, you know, he's on dry tires. We'll see if it stays dry. He may be in good shape. Excellent shape.
Yeah, and that's a point that we should bring up, is the fact that in most cases, he had to come in and repair mirror wing, it would have been very frustrating. But in this case, he was going to eventually have to come in to put on the dry
seat. He just took the time on this pit stop to be able to do both jobs.
While Unser Jr.'s had his problems, a man that continues to streak away is Emerson Fittipaldi here. Now, Fittipaldi is not over the past. Has that many great finishes here at Mid-Ohio, even though he's probably one of the better road racers on the kart circuit. But so far, he seems to have found the proper line, at least as this track continues to dry out. And that's good news for Emo, because, you know, Emo's had kind of an up-and-down year. He really came into it with a lot of expectations. And one of the things that we happened to ask Emerson just a couple of days ago is, how, in essence, does a driver find the best line around this Mid-Ohio racetrack?
In Mid-Ohio, you have to try to hit the apex of everything on the right place and really to run your car on the inside as much as you can go to the inside of the course. Because it's a so narrow track, every inch is important for a good lap time.
When you only have every inch playing such a critical role, how precise must you be, John?
Very precise. It can be one miscue can put you off in the grass, and as wet and as slippery and as muddy as it is out here today, I can guarantee you would slide a lot farther than you have ever thought you would, and when you get off. So Emerson is right. You've got to use every inch of the racetrack, and it's got to be just right. And there might be a wet spot in that place that you want to use, so you have to be ready for that. And these guys are the best at it. As we watch Emerson Fittipaldi, his last road course win in 1987, north of the border in Toronto, we haven't really begun to see. Oh, well, let's take a look at Raul Boisel, because he started shotgun on the field in row 13, and he's already being posted in fifth. And that's a good run, but again, it may account well because he's a former road racer, knows how to go in the wet. And the last time any of these kart guys ran in the wet was a year ago in Miami. Yes, it's, you know, Raul is an extremely good sports car racer, has won the World Driving Championship in that, and he's good. His car must be performing for him well. The Domino's beats the car, and so he's moving. And to come from dead last to fifth like that in this short period of time, says a lot for his car and his ability.
Well, they've had a shuffling of that team as well. Dennis Schwann has departed Team Shearson. The Domino's people seem not to have been too affected by it as Boisel continues to hurdle there. And we take a look at a pit stop by the Quaker State Porsche. A lot of people say this has been a difficult year for Al Holbert and Teo Bobby, but Teo's renewed with the team, and they are going to the dry. So we're beginning to see the exchanges of rubber here at Mid-Ohio as the track continues to dry out. We'll be bringing you more with the lead contingent here continuing to be Emerson Fittipaldi, Mario Andretti, and Bobby Rahal. Bob, you're looking at one of the first casualties from this race, Ari Lyandike, who was battered and bruised so badly at Pocono just two short weeks ago. The report from pit road is that his feet hurt just too bad to continue here in the Escort Radar Warning Detector 200 here at Mid-Ohio. A difficult time for the highly touted guy from Holland.
Yeah, it's really a shame. You know, Ari took a tremendous crash at Pocono a few weeks ago, and it's amazing to see him even in the car. You can see how gingerly he's getting out. They're bringing over crutches for him to hobble away from the car. He just wanted to get a chance to start today and see if he could handle it, and obviously with broken heels, that's not his day. So a big cheer for Ari Lyandike as he heads over to take a rest.
Emerson Fittipaldi, just moments ago, put Teo Bobby one lap down after the exchange of rubber. So he's continuing to set a torrid pace. And Johnny, the track is just about totally dry. So this team is going to have to consider a pit stop momentarily.
They are going to have to, because the tires now will start heating up, as we discussed earlier. Mario Andretti's in the pits. He's going for the dries, getting a little fuel. So, you know, this is going to be interesting, because here it rains again. We're going to see this whole thing all over again for the rain tires.
Well, Mario Andretti may have forced the issue just a bit, because he decided to be the first to pit Carl Haas, Tyler Alexander, and the rest of that crew, saying, hey, we couldn't keep the pace with Andretti, so let's force the issue for Emerson Fittipaldi. Fittipaldi still showing the rib tires, those Gatorback tires, but they're going to begin to come apart, and he's going to have to come into pit road very shortly. I'd like to welcome you, those of you that have been following the action in the Southern 500. We're here at the Radar Escort Warning Detector 200, and Emerson Fittipaldi is your leader. But the story thus far has been what was determined as a wet start has now been determined that dry tires, slick tires, are necessitated. Some of the lead contingent have already pitted. Danny Sullivan, Bobby Rahal,
Mario Andretti, but your leader here, Emerson Fittipaldi, continues to circuit the racetrack on wet tires, the rain tires, and now he presents his car on pit road. You can see him trying to go just as fast as he can to the service of the McLaren of the Marlboro pit from the Pat Patrick Racing Team. They will make the exchange, Johnny Rutherford, and
it's going to have to be quick because Mario has already made his stop and got the dry tires on. All of these precious seconds, they've refueled the car, they've got the tires on the car, he's away, he may be able to maintain the lead. Now they're making a wing change. There he goes. Now he's away. He might be able to maintain that lead. He had enough of a lead on Mario after Mario stopped, so this is going to be interesting to see.
So far it looks as if he's been able to make the exchange. Indeed he has. Emerson Fittipaldi continues to lead here. Mario Andretti in second. And for those of you that are watching the Southern 500, we're going to switch you back to Darlington right now. Back at Mid-Ohio, Emerson Fittipaldi is out front. But the man that has moved into second position, and we'll have to check with our pit commentators and see. I doubt it, Bobby Rahal. I may have been in error. I don't think Rahal has been in the pits yet, Johnny, to make the exchange, and he's being posted in that second position. Let's check with Larry Newber.
Well, Jack, you're absolutely right. Rahal has not come in yet. The last time he came around the carousel, the crew bolted over the wall anticipating Bobby's stop, and he went zipping past, and they all kind of looked at each other and said, well, I guess not this lap. They went back over the wall, and now all eyes are anxiously peering down toward the carousel. You know, the pit road goes uphill just a little bit here. They thoroughly anticipate Bobby coming in this time around, and if so, we'll be there to call the action for you.
Well, Larry, that's indeed what is happening. Bobby Rahal is presenting his car.
A.J. Foyt has stalled right in Bobby Rahal's pit. Now they're pushing Foyt's car back. He is back in the pit stall where he belongs. He is out of the way, but for a few inches moments there, he was running away where Bobby Rahal has to stop. Bobby comes to a stop here in the pit area. The car goes up on the air jacks. The rain tires go off. The slicks go on. Putting in the mandatory, of course, load of fuel. The very quick pit stop. A.J. Foyt is coasting incredibly slowly. Bobby steers around him and pulls away in a very rapid pit stop to change more tires.
Well, if he hadn't pitted Johnny Rutherford, he probably would have inherited the lead, but he had to come in and take it. In fact, you could see on those tires, they were pretty well used up.
He had to run an obstacle course getting in. He was dodging cars. There were several cars leaving at the same time he came in. There was another car coming in that he had to slow behind, and AJ's car stalled in his pit, so he's lucky to be able to get in and out that clean that quickly, and now all of the leaders are on the dry tires, and it'll be interesting now to watch what happens with the weather.
When something is unsettling as that happens on pit road, how long does it take for a driver to settle back down to the task at hand?
It's an immediate situation. You just deal with it as it happens, and then you move on to the next scenario. So the situation for Rahal is that he had all of that. It's exasperating. It feels like an eternity when you're slowing down and you've got to wait for all those people, but it's really only fractions of a second, and when you get back out, it's back to the job at hand. Get that car around the racetrack. Get accustomed to the slick tires on a little bit of moisture.
Now, getting accustomed to the slick tires as we watch Emerson Fittipaldi, and he looks as if he may indeed be attempting to try and find the line with the slicks.
Well, yes, he has to, and now, you know, as opposed to running with the wet tires, looking for the wet spots to get in to cool the tires down a little bit, he's looking for the dry spots, and most of the groove is dry now, it appears. There are some places where there's some moisture still lurking, but he's doing, he's running the car well, he's leading, and that's what every driver dreams about, is getting out in the lead. There you can see him up high, using that. Now he cuts down the inside, so the track is drying out.
Rounding out of the keyhole comes Emerson Fittipaldi, your leader, working the race traffic, trying to get around Ed Dim, who returns to the racing wars here in kart with a brand new car. But the thing that I'm kind of wondering about is we look at Bobby Rahal, and he indeed is trying to work around traffic too, right in front of him, Dale Coyne. Is can a driver tell the difference? Is it perceptible, the difference in speed and handling between the wet tires and the dry tires in these conditions?
Most definitely, and the thing is the frequency with the time it takes you to get from point A to point B is the thing you notice the most, and how comfortably you can do it.
Let's check in with Gary Lee. Gary's got some comments. Gary?
Well, most of these drivers, John, are coming in simply changing the tires and taking on the fuel. However, Emerson Fittipaldi had a front wing adjustment. I checked with Jim McGee. I said, what handling characteristic was wrong with the car that you had to compensate for? He said, we're simply compensating for the dry tires. So perhaps for the layman, can you explain how that characteristic differs and why they had to make that wing adjustment?
Well, I think probably what they're alluding to is the fact that on the wet tires, you don't have quite the grip. It grips better in the wet, but when you get on the dry, it doesn't want to grip quite as good. So you have to make a compensation. The dry tires on the dry grip much better in the front. That's a technical situation between the wet tires and the dry tires, but that's what it boils down to. And so they were just kind of making some fudge factor there and saying, okay, when we go to the dries, let's put a little front wing in it, and maybe that'll solve the whole problem and make the big picture look good.
Larry Newber, you've got some additional information on tires.
Yeah, Jack, once the track begins to dry out, those wet tires wear out very quickly. Now, here's the tires that just came off the front of A.J. Foyt's car. You can see the rubber beginning to peel up on each of the treads. They go rapidly once the track gets dry, and that's why it's so important that once the track gets dried out, they get these tires off. If the driver does not have an opportunity to come into the pits rapidly, he has to seek out the wet places on the racetrack to race until he can come into the pit area and get these changed.
Well, there are very few, in fact, precious few wet spots left on this racetrack here in Mid-Ohio, and it's dry, it's fast, and your leader continues to be Emerson Fittipaldi. Mario Andretti is second, Bobby Rahal third, and Raul Boisel is fourth.
In the pizza delivery game, the Noid can zap ordinary pizzas. But Domino's Pizza delivers more than all the others combined. So when you call ESPN.
Back here in Mid-Ohio, very precarious spin by number 23, the Fulvio Balbio car from Monte Carlo, and they just got it pulled out of the way, and especially with limited visibility, I don't think I'd want to be sitting in that car.
That's a real bad spot, of course, and if you are in a group of cars and you can't see, you could let it swing wide and, not even know he was there and clip the nose of that car, and it would be a problem.
Well, you come up over, as we look at Emerson Fittipaldi, he just came up over that ridge, and your visibility is very limited there. You've really got to be careful. Add the precipitation here and the slipping and sliding these cars are doing, and for the drivers coming up over that crest and then seeing that action, it could make your heart pause a couple of beats.
Yeah, it could skip a beat or two, I can assure you. It is very slippery on this brow, and when it's dry, you actually come over that. You can come over it hard enough to make the car get very light and get some wheel spin. So you can imagine what it would be like in the wet, where you've got water standing there on a spot that is polished off like that. It is very slippery.
There's your leader, Emerson Fittipaldi, coming up upon number 55. This is when race traffic really comes into play, and the visibility, Johnny, especially when you're working this race traffic. How do you compensate for the blindness that you've got? It's nearly not there. It's almost the case of where you're like running in smoke. You can't see anything. It's very thick. You can see as the car went away from the camera there a while ago, with the spray behind it, it blocks it, obliterates the car. And you see they have little lights, little tail lights on the cars, which we call rain lights. You have to turn those on when it starts raining. And when you can see how the spray gets on that, it's very, very dense, very heavy. You can't even see that light. So it's a situation where you've really got to be on your toes, and you drive your own race in your own race car. That's about all you can do.
Howdy Holmes got his car back started again, the Jimmy Mitchell special from the Alex Morales stable, and Emerson Fittipaldi passes him once again like he did several laps back. Fittipaldi has really slowed the pace down, especially in the madness portion of this course. He is really picking and choosing his line. And we notice the line is moved back out again.
Back out to that sandpaper edge where the cars don't run. You see him slide, he'll get right out against the gray part where the changes from the shiny to the flat color part. Here's that bad top where you rise over and you can get light when it's dry. Well, it's very slippery there. And of course, he's outside edge of the track. You can watch the classic wet road racing lines here. He's down there. You have to be, because you come out to the edge of the road very quickly here, down then heading for the carousel. And the proper line will be moved to the outside. There you can see him. He slips and slides, comes back across the inside. He's got the classic line, and it's very wet, wetter than when we started the race.
As we watch Emerson Fittipaldi, the car tends to dart, tends to move around. Is that the turbo coming in and out?
No, that's
that's actually a phenomenon of the chassis, the way the tires, you can see how the tires are, when you get a head-on shot of the car, the camber front end to make the radial tires work properly in the front of the car, and they're up on edges, so those little the edges, when you're going straight, want to pick up every little bump, and it makes the car pull around, and so it's very physical. Here's Emerson again, out against that outside, getting into that sticky part of the track.
So my question would be, do you fight that, or do you, as some drivers say, give the car its own head?
No, you have to fight it. You have to keep the car where you want it, because if you don't, it will run off of the road with you.
Well, Emerson Fittipaldi continues to lead, and now he has to hold his breath every once in a while, especially at this 3,100-foot rocket ride that he takes down into turn number six. And there he's a very classy example of visibility.
You can barely tell that was Mario Andretti. Just got a glimpse of the number in a white car, and that spray absolutely disappears. So you can imagine what it would be like running within two or three car lengths behind him at speed.
Well, also for Andretti, directly in front of him is Derek Daly in the Raynor special. And, you know, for Andretti, he's got a lot of poise, a lot of years. And, you know, he's got to be a little bit careful because he's being shown in the third position. For more on Mario Andretti and his situation, here's Gary Lee.
Well, I can assure you it is not pleasant down here. We had the umbrella talking with Carl Haas, the car owner, but because we were in the way of scoring, they couldn't see the track. They said, lose the umbrella. So here we stand out in the race. And, Carl, you're taking all the time to make all these notes, and Mother Nature is washing all the notes away.
That's the way it looks, yeah.
You obviously are not in contact with your driver right now, but for those that are, what is Mario saying about strategy right now with the weather conditions?
Well, we're just... I don't know if you have any real strategy. You try and keep everything on the road. Earlier on in the dry, our car wasn't handling too well, but we'll just see how it develops. The weather is appalling, so...
But realistically, if the car was not handling all that well in the dry, this could, in the long run, be an advantage to you guys.
Well, I don't... Not right now, no.
Well, obviously, a slight smile, but they're not real happy in the Andretti pit crew. Larry, what's it like down at your end?
Well, Gary, I'm at the opposite end from where you're standing. I'm right by the carousel, and I know that this is not high-speed IndyCar racing, but I don't know about the rest of you at home watching, but this is utterly fascinating to me. It really is, because you get to see skills from these race car drivers that you don't very seldom get to see. Who can really stand on the gas and get the most out of their machines on wet conditions like we have here? And Johnny, I want to ask you about this. It's much more an intellectual game than it is a physical or an athletic game. We see all kinds of different lines, different types of tactics being employed as they come around this carousel. And parts of this racetrack, particularly here in the carousel, have become so slow that drivers are comfortable enough to take at least one hand off of the steering wheel here and wipe the fog out from underneath their visor as they come around this corner. So it's much more mental than it is physical, isn't it?
Who told you that?
Not true, eh?
Listen, y'all take a ride in one of those things, try to keep it on that gray part out there instead of the green part, and it gets to be pretty dicey, and it's very physical. Not to contradict you that much, but it is.
Well, your leader here is the Marlboro car with Emerson Fittipaldi, but guess what? It's starting to clear one more, so we may be back to dry tires before this thing is over. Fittipaldi leads. Ray Hall second. This is Longhorns versus the BYU Cougars, live at 8 p.m. Eastern. Glad to be with us. The Longhorns open the season against one of their toughest opponents when they meet the Cougars. Both teams finished in their respective conferences last year, and Johnny, they've got the skill and the experience that need to take them right to the top. And talking about skill and experience,
yeah,
this guy needed some today. A.J. Voigt has spun. And
same place. Flavio spun a while ago, so it's very slick there. You know, this whole racetrack. Now we're hitting sunshine, and it's going to change again, so it's going to get interesting. Don't go away.
A lot of concern a couple of weeks ago, and you relieved A.J. Voigt at Michigan with his bruised kidney, and they were very concerned about him. You've had a chance to talk to A.J. He's in fine fettle now.
Yes, he's a racer. You know, A.J. Likes to race, and he's 53 years old, you know, and he's... People keep telling him, you know, AJ, you ought to quit, you ought to retire. And he says, oh, when I want to, I'll retire. And I think that's great. That's the same way I feel about it. You know, I'm trying to put something together and I'm going to get it done and want to go racing.
Richard Petty once said, when it stops being fun, I'll get out of the race car. And I think that's the same for a guy like AJ Voigt. Fellow that's having a lot of fun today is Bobby Rahal. You know, Rahal is still being posted in second position. We've alluded to the fact that he has so many miles here on this home course. And in the wet, in the dry, you need to rely on your experience, certainly more in the wet. And it's been a tumultuous week for Bobby Rahal with the announcement that he was leaving the Budweiser True Sports team. For the first time in his racing career, he's going to drive for someone else. Bob Jenkins, one of our colleagues from the Southern 500 had a chance to visit and examine the whole question about Rahal.
Newspaper accounts of the switch played on the emotions of both sides, implying there was bad blood between Rahal and True Sports co-owner Steve Horn, and between Andretti and Craco owner Maury Cranes.
Was there a personal conflict with Steve or anybody else in True Sports?
No, I mean, somehow that got out, or somebody, you know, I don't even know, because I think at Elkhart Lake, somebody, or at, not Elkhart, but Michigan, somebody said something to me. I said, no, absolutely not.
Do you have any changed feelings because of this toward the Craco team?
No, not at all. You know, I mean, we're separating, but we're still friends, and, you know, I have no problem. You know, the morale is still the same. I'm going to go out and drive the same these next five races. I'm going to give it all I have. You know, I'm not going to have any hard feelings against Craco at all.
With the Mid-Ohio race this weekend, it was business as usual on Wednesday for both teams. True Sports preparing their Judd-powered Lola at their shops just outside Columbus, Ohio, and the Craco team with Andretti driving his Cosworth-powered Lola on a road course for the first time at Memphis Motorsports Park in Tennessee. Although he leads points, Rahal has been frustrated all season because of the Judd's lack of horsepower. The chance of a Chevy, which has been the dominant force in IndyCar racing this year, caused the switch.
I felt that for me to even have an opportunity of having that, that I had to make the change. Otherwise, it would not happen here. That was made very clear to me.
It seems that one of Bobby's main reasons for switching was the possibility of a Chevy engine next year. Do you see that happening for Craco?
Well, we're keeping our fingers crossed. I think right now the Chevy engine is definitely the engine to have. It's more competitive at the moment.
Do you think the Judd is going to be just as good as the Chevy?
I think right now we're within 2 or 3% of a Chevrolet in terms of pure horsepower. We made a decision, I think, which is, again, I'll reiterate it, a long-term decision, a three-year decision, to have control of our own destiny with engines. Chevrolet have done a tremendous job, I think, with their program, but if I join them, I only become another runner. We're looking for dominance, and I really believe we'll achieve that.
Has Bobby made a mistake, in your opinion?
Yes.
But that's all. Bobby Rahal, at least according to Steve Horn, has made a mistake. What about you, Johnny Rutherford? Has Rahal made a mistake?
You got to do what you got to do, and I think you've got to live with the results no matter what they are, and Bobby obviously has made his decision, and that's the way it's going to be.
If you were in the position, what would you have done?
Well, it's hard to say. It's an awfully nice home over there at True Sports. Good, solid operation. Of course, the other operation is a good, solid operation, too. So I can't see that it's going to hurt him. Maybe if they don't get the Chevrolet engine, then that could be another story.
Well, obviously, it has not affected his performance here at Mid-Ohio. He's still being shown in second position, trailing Emerson Fittipaldi. The sun has begun to come out as Rahal works down through the 7 and 8 area, what we like to call the back 40 here in Mid-Ohio, and prepares to come to the carousel and complete another lap. We're working the 42nd lap, so we're exactly halfway in this event with Rahal running behind Fittipaldi. Mario Andretti is still shown in third. Rick Mears is holding on to fourth. Bozell is fifth. But here is a battle that is beginning to develop for sixth and seventh spot between two real strong runners. That's John Jones, Scott Pruitt, and Danny Sullivan, who is now being shown in eighth, and they are dicing for position. Pruitt is trying to get to the inside of Jones as they continue to battle for sixth spot. Two young guys that are really beginning to make their mark known.
Yes, John Jones is leading in the points chase for the Rookie of the Year honors in the championship auto race teams, and of course Scott Pruitt is getting his start, so to speak. This is his third or fourth start in IndyCars, and he's had a busy weekend running Trans Am and other types of race cars here, so he's a man on the go. He's up and coming and has a great deal of talent.
And as we watch the battle here and we look at Pruitt, we're going to see Pruitt trying to get around John Jones. He looked to the inside there, Johnny, as they started to go down there, and that race traffic's getting in the way just a little bit in terms of what he wants to do, and now he goes to the high side and tries to take that position. He seems to be able to get around the race traffic, and let's see if he can, is that Jones? Yeah, he's trying to get around Jones, and so far that battle continues to be Newberg's song, but let's, while we watch this, check in with Larry Hoover. Larry?
Well, Jack, had this been 5 years ago, Scott Pruitt would have been tearing around Mid-Ohio on a go-kart. You talked about his busy weekend. He's jetting back and forth from Lime Rock in Connecticut to here to run both a couple of the divisions, IndyCars as well as sedans. This is Mark Bridges, Scott's crew chief for this weekend. What's he saying? Does he feel like he's having a good ride?
Yeah, he's real comfortable right now. It's wet, naturally, but everything's fine. He's just taking his time.
I would imagine this rain is a big advantage for him. This puts him on a much more even footing with the rest of the IndyCar veterans.
Well, it does. You know, right at the moment, I think everybody's equal. Okay, when the track dries out, we'll see where we stand. We just moved into sixth right now. So he's just taking his time.
He has done so well in Trans Am and GTO. Does this team have any further plans for Scott in the future?
We can't say right at the moment.
Scott Pruitt is definitely one of the stars of the future, though, Jack and Johnny.
Well, and he is also subbing for an injured driver, and that, of course, Kevin Kogan, who injured his arm there in Toronto several races ago. Kogan had hoped to drive the Schaefer Machinist Union car here, but as you know, Johnny, those things don't heal, especially in a road course like this where you got to use the ship.
Another thing, too, Kevin Kogan is a new daddy. He has a new son. So, you know, he's mixed emotion. He'd rather be here racing, but he's got a new son to think about now.
So, one man's problems become another man's opportunities here at Mid-Ohio as Pruitt replaces Kogan. But Emerson Fittipaldi continues to lead this event, followed by Ray Hall, Andretti, Mears, and Bozell.
Dodge Shadow ES. When you look at its 60 standard features, its turbocharged engine, its 770 protection plan, when you consider the fact that the Shadow ES is a better value, almost $700 less than the Chevy Cavalier C24, you'll agree, when it comes to outstanding value, it's gotta be a Dodge.
Now save up to $1,440 with cash back and package discounts on selected Dodge cars in stock.
Mid-Ohio, along with Johnny Rutherford, Larry Newbert, Gary Lee, and these enthusiastic fans that, despite the weather, have turned out to challenge and cheer their favorites here at the Mid-Ohio Racecourse. You know, it's always great to come to Mid-Ohio. It's one of the better run facilities in road racing, and these fans appreciate that, Johnny.
They really do, and of course, you can see how thick they are right there. I don't know what, maybe they think the body heat will keep the rain off of them or something, but they're in there.
At the halfway mark, your leader continued to be Emerson Fittipaldi. This man has moved in as we are now presently working the 46 lap, but let's take a look at the mid-race recap. Fittipaldi led 32 of the 42 laps, and that's a darn good average speed.
Yes, it is, considering all the wet we've been in.
The pitted on laps 13 and 27, that of course due to the fact that we had going from wet tires to dry tires and back. We've had no cautions for no laps, no full course cautions. We've had 4 leaders, 7 lead changes, and 22 cars remain out on the racetrack, which is a good indication of the quality of competition here in kart.
Yes, the guys are paying attention, and it is wet out there. It's very slippery. You can see the spray off of the tires, the cars. It's drying out a little bit because we've got a breeze and some sunshine trying to creep in here, and if it gets a chance, it may be that we'll see a dry finish to this race anyway.
So let's take a look at the out of race. We've talked to Michael Andretti. We showed you Ari Leyendyke, why he went out. Dale Coyne, who had an engine expire. Darren Brasfield, another newcomer to IndyCar racing,
yes,
that did hope to do well today, but he'll get another chance another day. And your leader continues to be Emerson Fittipaldi, and many people say that he's one of the better road racers in the wet. But let's check in with Gary Lee. Gary?
Well, we're keeping an eye right now on the flags, the weather, and the wind. The wind appears to be coming from the southwest, and from that direction, we have, for the most part, clear skies, which would indicate we could well finish this race under dry conditions. Now, the strategy here in the pit area of the leader, Emerson Fittipaldi, is this. They want to change to dry tires and take on the last of the fuel at about lap 52. That would be in that window that would get them to the end of the race. However, they can only hope the track is dry enough at that time to take on the dry tires. So far, he's gone through one set of wet ones, one set of dry ones. He has a wet set on now, and in the pit area, we have 2 sets of wet and 2 sets of dry. We have plenty of tires, but if the track dries out, look for your leader to stop on lap 52 for dry tires and fuel.
And you know, there you could see a good indication of Fittipaldi, Johnny, trying to seek out the wet a little bit.
Still too dry. Still too wet out there. It's not dry enough for him. You saw him fishtail as he tried to really squeeze it off of the corner there, taking the low line down inside to try to get by Bozell. It's still very slippery. A lot of water out there. So the sunshine on it, it's going to remain to be seen. But Emerson's still doing a perfect job.
And Fittipaldi is utilizing a lot of hand gestures as he works through that race traffic. Is that really important, especially when you come up on a guy the way he has?
No, I think it's indicative of a South American nature. You know, he's very vocal, and he was waving a thank you or shaking his fist and get out of the way next time. I'm going to come back through.
Emerson Fittipaldi, a man of many things, former Formula One world champion. A lot of people wrote him off when he retired from F1, and a renewed enthusiasm when he came to kart championship racing. And now he calls Miami his part-time home and starts to build boats. Have you seen the boats that Emerson Fittipaldi has now?
Magnificent boats. I think Chris Kraft builds the boat, and it's called the Fittipaldi, and it's bright red and it's magnificent.
Now, one of the things that might happen here is a change in history. We see all the past winners have started in the first two rows. Guess where Fittipaldi started? In the third row.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, things happen.
Now they say rules are made to be, records are made to be broken, right?
Yes.
But there's still a lot of racing to go, and you don't ever want to write one of these off to one of the front runners, especially with the changes back and forth in the track.
Not, especially not under these conditions. There he's coming up on Roberto Guerrero, trying to get himself established in Roberto's mirror, so when Roberto checks, he sees him and lets him have the chance to get by. He's by on the kink of the backstretch, very fast through there, flat out, even though it is wet, and down, breaking hard into the madness corner. Staying to that edge of the grade, trying to get that little bit of traction so he can get off of there with some throttle and carry some speed on up to the next turn.
His sponsored cousins in Formula One competition have actually made a shambles out of the chase for the world championship, and that, of course, were the Marlboro McLarens. And a lot of conversation over the last 2 years that Fittipaldi, with the sponsorship of Marlboro, may entice Ron Dennis and company to come stateside and field the competitive kart PPG car.
Well, I think you've heard that's a definite rumor, and I talk to people that I think should know the answer to that or have some insight, and I get some grins, and I get some definite no's, and oh, I wouldn't think so's, and who knows. So it's one of those things where if they do, they'll be a contender, I guess.
One thing that we know for sure, Ron Dennis has been stateside several times. Not necessarily at the race, but he's watched a lot of IndyCar competition. So who knows what may portend. And there you see Fittipaldi wiping his visor. And let's, when we look at race strategy, I think Larry Newber can give us a little bit of insight from the pit.
Oh, Jack, let me lay out a couple of questions for you and Johnny and maybe Gary to ponder on. Down here at this end of the pits, the Penske people say that they're going a little further than the 52 laps for their next pit stop, which could well be their final fuel stop. They say, maybe 56, 57, maybe as many as lap number 58. However, right now the sun is shining brightly. Nobody expects the rest of this race to run with a wet track. They are all anticipating they're going to have to change to slicks if this bright sun stays out and the sky stays blue. But they don't think the track will be dry by the time this first round of pit stops come in. So, what do you do when you come in if the track is partially wet? Do you change to the dry tires and wait for the track to come to you? Or do you stay on the rain tires and then make a second pit stop later when the track dries out? The question is, which will cost you more time? What do you think?
Well, I think it'll cost you more time if you don't change. Because you've got to come back in and make that four-tire change to the dries again, or to the wets, or from the wets to the dries. So, you know, the situation with the fuel and them being able to go a little longer, I would think you're not running as hard, using as much throttle in the wet, so you're conserving a little fuel. So that's why they're able to go, I think, the extra few laps in order to stretch the situation. The longer they can stretch it, the better their opportunities of going from the wet tires to the dry tires and making it to the end. So it's a gamble. You know, it's a roll of the dice. And I think, personally, that you've got to just kind of wait to see how long you can go and hope that your fuel light's working properly and you get a chance to use it.
Well, there you could see Fittipaldi fishtailing as he rounded a corner there. He's continuing to work this car just as hard as it possibly can go. But one thing, as he comes up on Ludwig Heimrath Jr. in the McKenzie car working into the keyhole, one thing that nobody seems to be too concerned about today are brakes. And normally, here in Mid-Ohio, brakes are a major concern. And it's the source of our quick back today with Larry Newber.
This quick fact is brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The Big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
This device is illegal in kart on an oval. It's a brake duct designed to keep the front brakes cool. Now, it's not required on a road course, but it's just about mandatory if you want the brakes to go all the way to the distance. Now, the cars do have four-wheel brakes, but obviously most of the attention on a road course is here in the front end. Those brake ducts may take many, many different shapes and sizes on an Indianapolis car in the pits. It's not the only precaution you can make also to keep the brakes cool. The brake pads get a lot of extra attention. These are the carbon fiber-based brake pads rather than the old copper and asbestos type. Also, the rotors on the inside are ventilated. Now, the optimum operating temperature for brakes during a race is between 460 and maybe 660 degrees. But still, despite all those factors, the most important factor continues to be the driver's right foot.
And that right foot is getting a workout today, maybe not necessarily getting hard on the brakes, but feathering the brakes, using the accelerator, trying to make it work to your advantage. The sun is popping through one more time here at Mid-Ohio, so we could be shuffling the deck again with rain tires and slicks. Fittipaldi, Ray Howell, Andretti, Mayers, and Bozell lead.
Quaker State.
Ohio, the sun has come out, and you're beginning to see the track continuing to dry, but your leader is as he's been for quite some time, both on slick tires and now on rain tires, Emerson Fittipaldi. Now, Johnny Rutherford, Fittipaldi's going to have to seek out some of those wet spots to keep those tires cool.
Yes, the track is still, it's right in that limbo stage. It's very miserable right now because there are more wet spots than dry, and you can't depend on it, so you've got to kind of pick your way around. As you can see, Emerson is really not running real hard there, but he's running just hard enough to maintain. The car is handling extremely well, and he's done a marvelous job today.
We've got 53 of the 84 laps completed, and I want to remind you that towards the end of this race, we'll be announcing the Goodyear Eagle Driver of the Race Award, and Goodyear will be giving $1,000 to CARA, the Championship Auto Racing Auxiliary, in that driver's name. And Johnny, there's quite a few nominees for that award today.
Oh, we definitely have. Some of the guys have been around for a while, and some rookies that have certainly done a marvelous job.
Working race traffic again is Emerson Fittipaldi, and you know, it looks almost effortless right now, but really, this is the time when you've got to mind your P's and Q's, because as you said, the racetrack is in such a precarious position, such a tough situation. It could go one way or the other.
Yes, it is, and of course, you can see that some places on the track, the spray is non-existent from the tires, and other places, it's still a pretty good spray. So there we see Emerson going by Rocky Moran and moving on through the traffic, heading on toward his next pit stop, which could come, well, just any time, a little bit down the road. And, of course, make a decision then to whether he wants to go from the wet tires to the dry tires. And at this point, I would say it's still wet tire territory out there.
And yet, these are the calls that, what, does the driver make them, or does the crew chief and the team owner make them?
Well, the crew chief and the team owner are a little bit manacled at that point because they don't know what the conditions are out there. And that's a call of Emerson's. I think he has to be on the radio, and if the radio goes on the fritz, then the crew's got to be really on their toes and be ready for him at any point.
And this man continues to impress many here in one of his limited kart IndyCar engagements. Subbing for Kevin Cogan, Scott Pruitt is showing absolutely the maturity of a veteran as he works the facility here and the different conditions. And, you know, he's moved up into fifth position. He's gotten around Bozell. And this is a great run for this young man, a winner in the International Race of Champions in Riverside, California this year. And he had hoped that his IROC performances would maybe get him some attention on a national level, and it seems that maybe it has.
Well, he's doing it, as we've said, a stellar job in that car. There he gets, it gets a little dicey there. He's trying to make a move, and
that wasn't dicey. He got cut off by Heimrath.
He really did, and we'll see now what happens, who moves where. If Heimrath goes to the outside, there you can see Bozell moving on the inside.
This is a battle for fifth position, people, and look at Bozell, and they are side by side as they work the crest of the tire. Yeah, that was a bump and
all. Bump, and he got into the fence. That's a shame. It's Scott Pruitt touched the front of Bozell's car. They came together, and it threw him out of control, and he went right straight into the arm go on the side. I don't know whether he's pinned in there. It doesn't look like it. He is starting to scramble, trying to get out of the car. It's obviously his feet are not pinned. The safety people are there. Local people are right there at the moment.
let's take a look at what happened here. As it was coming into Madness, again working race traffic, and the man that took the advantage actually was Bozell. Bozell got a little crossways there,
Yes, you can see right there. They bump, and it turns him offline. He goes across into the grass, loses control, bang, sudden stop. That's got to be a frustration for Scott Pruitt. There he's out of the car, walking away, in good shape,
Bring out a full course yellow. But the question I've got for you, Johnny Rutherford, is if the track conditions were dry all weekend, would the same have happened?
Probably not, because that is still one of the wetter parts of the course. We can see the car slipping and sliding. So at this point, it's going to be interesting. Here we see Mario Andretti coming in. We'll watch now to see if he takes the chance and goes to the dries.
It looks like he's going to.
So Mario is a master at making the change. He's putting on the slick tires. It's going to be dicey, but he's going to have that advantage of already being on the dries, out there, ready when the track dries out. So this could have been a very good strategic move for Mario.
With the luxury of a full course yellow, would not most of the front runners have to at least think a lot harder about coming in and putting those dries on, because you can extend your fuel mileage? And, people like Rick Mears, I understand, is in on pit road, and Larry Neuber, I think that's exactly what they're going to do as well, right?
Jack, he absolutely is. Rick Mears comes to a stop, and there was no question, no hesitation. The slicks went on. This is the trickiest part going to be for all of these drivers exiting pit road. There is a great deal of water on pit road. Danny Sullivan's crew is over the wall. They, too, are going to slicks. Little Al Unser Jr.'s crew is getting ready for him. They, too, are going to slick. So everyone's going to take the calculated risk. Johnny, you called it. You said, hey, they've got to take the chance of making only one pit stop rather than two, because they don't expect any yellow pit in Ohio the rest of the way.
You can't take it easy out there on the slicks, and it's still, we can see the moisture on the tires. Some places you can get away with it. Other places it's still too damp. So if the sun is shining, the wind is blowing a little bit, and if they get this opportunity, boy, the guys that have made the change early will be in the catbird seat.
Well, with all the exchanges here on pit road with rain tires and slick tires, a lot of flip-flopping back and forth in positions, and we'll straighten it all out after these commercial messages.
Fixing this water damage will cost $1,200.
Going CART PPG IndyCar World Series Championship coverage will be from beautiful Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin, in the Road America Briggs & Stratton 200. That'll be going to post at 3:30 p.m. Eastern Time on Sunday, September 11th. The plan to be with us is we certainly have one of the tightest races for the championship battle here, as we've gone back to green flag activity, and Mario Andretti has appropriated the lead with 59 laps completed of the 84 scheduled today. This is all indicative of what took place during that full course caution when Andretti, Johnny Rutherford, elected to be the first man on pit road.
Yes, he came in, put on the dry tires, and we can see the track is drying, and Mario there shown leading the race with Emerson Fittipaldi, who has led most of the day in second.
And Fittipaldi had a very lucky close escape on pit road. We'll tell you about that in a couple of moments. Mears is in third position. Ray Hall has dropped back to fourth after stalling. In fifth is Teo Fabi. A good run for Fabi after some problems. Sullivan, Unser Jr. also coming back from problems. Those two drivers. John Jones still in the hunt in eighth position. Raul Boisel, who stalled momentarily on the race course. They got it restarted. He's in ninth. And the Irishman from Dublin, not Ohio, from Ireland, Derek Daly, runs in tenth position. Let's take a look at the signature in pit stop efficiency. There you see again that Emerson Fittipaldi with 33.32 total time. Bobby Rahal, there you see a real tough one for him because his car stalled. And that decreased his pit stop efficiency. Mario Andretti at 32.63. And Rick Mears, very quick at 27.38. And that indeed should account for the reason why he's running in third position. Now, we talked about the problems that Emerson Fittipaldi had. He was literally saved from a major disaster on pit road just moments ago when he came in to take on fuel and exchange tires. Here's what happened, Johnny Rutherford.
Yes, he was in the pits. The guy came off with the hose, which is supposed to be the indication. He nearly runs over the guy, but you can see the vent line is still hooked to the car. It had stuck in the receptacle.
And the man that went just a skittering into pit wall is Larry Faust. And Gary Lee, you're there. Larry's going to certainly be a little black and blue tomorrow.
The first car
Well, there was some concern that they did not get enough fuel in during that stop because of the miscommunication. Now, Larry Fowles has now recapitulated everything that happened and says, yes, we think we have about 30 gallons of fuel in the car. They knew they had about 19 gallons of alky in the car's fuel tank at that last stop, so they got at least 11 gallons in. That should be enough to go the distance for Emo.
Now, Johnny, as we saw, the fuel vent hose came unhinged. So one of the things that you do is you recapture all of that fuel in the vent hose,
yes,
to pour back into the tank to make an accurate measurement. So it's really kind of seat-of-the-pants calculations right now.
It is, for a fact, and that could be one of the things to watch for Emerson toward the end of this race, is just how much fuel he did get and whether it is going to be marginal for him.
Don't know if it's the Latin blood in Emerson Fittipaldi or the fact that he knows that he may be running on borrowed time, but he is closing quickly on your leader, Mario Andretti, as they work through the switchbacks and prepare to present themselves at the keyhole. Now, there's 5th, 6th, and 7th. Teo Bobby leads Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan. Bobby, you recall, had some problems, and of course, we certainly chronicled the problems that have befallen Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan. They are a lap down to your leaders, but they are battling with, you know, this is a chase for points, too, because these guys, second and third in the point standings, and Danny Sullivan, who after Pocono, I mean, really before Pocono, thought he had a commanding lead for the championship. Great battle here.
Yes, it is. Jr. has moved by. They both moved by. He and Sullivan, and Sullivan is pressing Al Jr. So this could be the battle here, you know, for the points thing. It depends on where Ray Hall and Emerson wind up.
Sullivan is so mild-mannered when he's in front of a camera. You know, he says all the right things. But many people say that once he straps himself in the cockpit and gets the shield, and look.
Oh, no.
There's Ray Hall and Ludwig Heimrath.
Ludwig Heimrath Jr. are both off. Ray Hall is against the guardrail there. He's taking the... Uh-oh, he's coming out of the car.
He's not at all happy.
No, he is not. He's going over to have a few words with Heimrath Jr., and that's really a shame. You know, I'm sure Ray Hall is certainly upset, and rightfully so, about that, because that's the point. When you get in that situation, here's the replay. We'll watch and see exactly what happened.
Remember, we've talked about race traffic for many, many times,
yes,
throughout this race. Let's see what happens.
Here he comes up on the inside, tries to make... Oh, and he lost it. That was the problem. He lost it in a slick spot, and they both...
You can't fault Heimrath for that.
No, you really can't. But that's racing, and that's the way it goes, and it's sickening for in Bobby's place, leading in the points. Now he's obviously going to lose that position to one of the other guys, and...
Should anyone speculate that with the change of teams that Bobby Rahal would give anything less than 100%?
No, 110.
I think this display shows that it's more like 120.
Yes, he is very upset, and it's a shame for both guys.
Now, this makes the battle for 5th, 6th, and actually 5th, 6th, and 7th that much more important right now between the lap cars of Al Unser Jr. specifically and Danny Sullivan, because there aren't a lot of points separating those three guys. And with Ray Hall, and I'm sure by now they've seen Ray Hall up against the wheel fence, they've got to be thinking about points.
Oh, yes. Things start, wheels start grinding and turning, and you start thinking about the situation, and you've got to put yourself in the best spot. And of course, you don't want to wind up like that, so you've got to make all of the right moves.
And that will change things in the record books for Bobby Rahal. He's never finished out of the top three here at Mid-Ohio, but he certainly will today. And a lot of disappointment for Bobby Rahal, I'm sure. But as they say, they'll come another day. But I think the battle right now, well, there's two on the racetrack, and let's update you on them. This one here, of course, is Mario Andretti and Emerson Fittipaldi, and then the battle that we've accounted for, Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan. But another player in this switch and in this heartbreak down there in the corner that went up against the wheel fence is Bobby Rahal's team owner, and that, of course, is Steve Horn.
Jack, this is Steve Horn. Steve, what do you hear from Bobby from the cockpit about the incident?
What Bobby said was Heimrath took him out.
You guys have to be very deflated, because you had another good run going here, and after this week, it was very important that I think everyone showed that you were still behind this effort as a team 110%.
Well, I think, you know, we've still got four races to go, so we're not out of the hunt. I think a little bit of disappointment, surely, but you know, we'll keep on going.
I realize very much that this is not the right place, the right time, and your mind is not in this mode, but as you look ahead to 1989, any idea what direction you might go? Are you going after somebody that's on an established IndyCar team right now, or maybe bringing somebody else who's not in the league right now?
To be quite honest, we really haven't thought about it. We're just trying to get through this, through these two races, get some points in the championship, then look at next year.
Well, Jack and Johnny, over the last two seasons, this guy and this team has done better at getting points and getting through these last few races than anybody else in IndyCar racing.
Well, that's truly a shame that Bobby Rahal is up against the fence, but we've got some racing going on here, I can assure you.
Now, this may be a battle only for fifth, but you could call it the championship battle, at least as far as Mid-Ohio is concerned. Danny Sullivan trails Al Unser Jr., and they are continuing to go at it hammer and tong as we work through the madness portion of this race and road course. We'll update you on this battle and the battle for the lead when we come back. Jack Arute back with you at Mid-Ohio. We've completed 65 laps, and it is boiling up front. Mario Andretti continues to lead directly behind him, as you can see, is Emerson Fittipaldi. And behind them in that battle we alluded to in fifth and sixth, although they're a lap down, is Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan. Now let's break this out for you. Andretti leads by virtue of the fact that he was the first to enter pit road and put on slick tires. But Fittipaldi came charging back after a near miss that almost cost him going out of the race when his vent hose came unhinged and cost him valuable seconds on pit road. But he is closed now and continues to challenge as the leaders work through the switchback and come up to the keyhole to complete another circuit here. Danny Sullivan, as you can see, looks in front of him and sees Al Unser Jr. They are one lap down to the lead contingent, but they are engaged in a battle of their own as they try to gain valuable championship points in their quest for the championship, knowing that Bobby Rahal is already out of this event, Johnny Rutherford.
Boy, they are going hard after it, too. Sullivan knows that he's got to get the advantage on Al Unser Jr. and get up front.
And look at this, Fittipaldi. Fittipaldi makes that challenge down on the inside. They come across the blind crested brow. Fittipaldi thinks better of it, but Fittipaldi is really showing the heat on Mario Andretti. He's backed off for a second. Is he going to take a run at him again as they get set up for that 13, 14, and 15 area of the track?
This is very hard to pass back here. You've got to catch a guy really out of shape in order to get by on this front section of the course. But we're coming back around to the front straightaway and going through the carousel. We may see Emerson pull back up and get in position to try to make a run at Mario through those long stretches of the racetrack.
Okay, with what is in front of them in this other portion of the racetrack, where's the best place to pass?
Well, I think probably the best place is going to obviously be down the long straightaway and into madness. So it's right here is where he has to use the legs on his car to be able to pull up in contention to catch Mario. But Mario is not slowing down. You can see he's still holding that gap. And if he can get through this part of the course, get through the keyhole, close any distance, maybe he'll have a chance to run at him down the straightaway. And of course, you've got the other two cars, Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan sitting right there waiting to get back in the lead lap.
Two Chevrolets up front battling 1-2. It's a question of horsepower. The four cars that you see here, in fact, are powered by Chevrolet. And they are, well, let's, again, Fittipaldi try to move to the inside. Was he throwing Andretti a dummy, or is he just running out of horsepower?
I think he's got just enough. He probably needs to get off of the keyhole just a little bit better. And here Mario seems to be better down in the tight stuff. He's maybe geared a little differently. Something may be working better for Mario, or he might just be running for it.
You know, we've talked about a lot of the drivers that turned this portion to good fortune this weekend. One of them may indeed be Mario Andretti. He was the first driver in early practice to crash his car coming out of turn 15. He sandwiches up against the start-finish line on the outside retaining barrier, and this is his backup car, the Kmart Amoco Ultimate Special from the Carl Haas stable, and this is about right where Andretti crashed in the first practice session of the weekend, but they battled back and now leads Emerson Fittipaldi as they circuit turn one and head back upstairs to the keyhole portion of the racetrack. And here's where you can haul the mail through what we call the switchbacks, turns two and three.
Yes, and Mario gets through there extremely well. All of those top four guys we see in the picture running there are staying glued right together. And here's where Emerson has to get that extra bit of speed, get off of that turn to maintain the speed and pick him up at the end and try to get by. He's not going to do it this time. Mario is there. He's still pushing. So that last half of the straightaway, Emo is able to close up, but it's not quite enough.
You can't see it in the picture, but there is a slight kink. When Emerson Fittipaldi hits that peak area on the backstretch, he gains a little bit of an advantage, maybe a hundredth of a second.
That's very hard to say because that kink is so subtle. It's just a dog leg to the right. But here you can see they're all four under a blanket, and it's an interesting race.
The man that's been following the fortunes of Emerson Fittipaldi from Pitt Road is Gary Lee. Gary, you've got a comment.
Well, a comment, in fact, Jack, on both Emo and on Mario. You'll recall earlier that Carl Haas said the car was not handling all that well before they went to the rain tires the second time. When they made that tire change, they made some adjustments to Mario's front wing. Mario has not made any indication since then if, in fact, that corrected the handling difficulty. Now, according to the Emo camp, he has always been able to use that Chevrolet horsepower to run somebody down, then outbrake them. He can't do that now because Andretti also has a Chevrolet. So it's a dogfight between two former world champions, both with the same chassis and both with the same power plant.
Well, now let's see as they work down the 3,100-foot backstretch one more time if Emerson Fittipaldi may have just a slight advantage as he continues the assault. This time he tries the outside.
No, he still can't quite. That's the closest he's been so far, and he's making a move. He is going around on the outside. He gets to the edge of the grass, makes the move. Fantastic drive by Emerson Fittipaldi, going by Mario Andretti.
That was artistic. There's no other word
no,
for it.
No, that was a perfect textbook, picture book pass.
Let's take a look one more time at this pass. It was not telegraphed. It was just a case of being in the right place and painting the perfect picture for a pass.
It was incredible. I think he had watched Mario trying to close that door on the inside. He took a chance and went to the outside, used that sandpaper edge of the track to get by, and made a perfect pass.
So Emerson Fittipaldi is reappropriated the front position from Mario Andretti. Andretti drops back to second. Now, in the meantime, the fellows that have had the best view of all this action are continuing their own battle directly behind these two cars. The battle, as we said, one lap off the lead pace, but a battle for championship points. The fourth car in your picture is Danny Sullivan. Directly in front of him is Al Unser Jr. Sullivan in the Miller American Special. Unser Jr. in the Valvoline Special, and they are battling for championship points. And as I was about to say several laps ago, Danny Sullivan, so calm, cool, and collected, when he slaps down the visor and is all alone in the race car, many say he has one of the better killer instincts in racing. And another man that can do likewise is Al Unser Jr., and he's beginning to climb all over Mario Andretti, and that will be costly to Andretti in his chase for Fittipaldi.
Well, there he made the move, but didn't quite get the job done. Mario appears to be slowing just a little bit over what he was, and it's very hard to say at this point because either Emerson, he was holding Emerson up and it didn't appear that way, or he's got some sort of a little nagging handling problem, but the other two have closed in very close to him.
Now, Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan are one lap off the pace. Mario Andretti is on the lead lap with Emerson Fittipaldi. How fair is it for a guy a lap down to be racing with a guy that's chasing the lead lap?
Well, racing's racing, and obviously they want to get back in the lead. If something were to happen to those two lead cars, that would leave little Al sitting there in the right spot, and Sullivan as well. So, you just go out and race, and you don't jeopardize your position or your situation at this stage of the game. When it gets a little later in the race, we're allowed to see some real action here.
Now, we've been alluding to the fact of how close this points chase is. Danny Sullivan, if the race should end in its present set of circumstances, with Sullivan trailing Al Unser Jr., he would have a one-point lead over little Al in the points battle. That's a difference of one pole position point for Danny Sullivan. So this is really going to go right down to Miami, I'm sure. And there again, Mario Andretti went very, very wide. Al Unser Jr. got the advantage. They come across the blind crested brow, and Unser Jr.'s on his way, and now Danny Sullivan's going to try. And it seems quite obvious now that Mario is either backed out of the throttle or maybe, just maybe, the handles have gone away just a bit.
I think it's probably a handling situation. Mario's not the guy to get out of the throttle and let somebody by. And he knows that he's got to give somebody a chance. And I'm sure we'll see Sullivan get by him here if he sits there in the mirrors very much longer. So Mario Andretti, I would say, has got a handling problem at this point. Maybe just a little bit. Doesn't take much. You know, these cars are so finicky that if you get one little bit of fitty thing out of sync, it can really give you grief. And so he may have just that one little bitty thing. If Sullivan gets by, he's going to have to maintain to charge up there.
Well, the championship chase is coming to full boil, as well as the chase for victory here in Mid-Ohio. So don't go away, because there's plenty of racing left. We've completed 72 of the 84, with Fittipaldi in front and Andretti second. Mears, Unser Jr., and Sullivan round out the top five.
laps left in this afternoon. Escort Radar Warning 200. I'm Jack Arute along with Johnny Rutherford, Larry Newbler, and Gary Lee. And your leader is Emerson Fittipaldi, who just climbed the ladder and took the lead away in a great move from Mario Andretti, who was dropped back to second. In third is this man, Rick Mears. Not one of the best road racers in racing, but he says, hey, I want to prove that I'm a good road racer. He's driven a very conservative race. He is holding on to third position, and standing by is his car owner, Roger Penske. Let's go check in with him on pit road.
Well, Jack, we're watching intensely. Roger's keeping track of Rick each lap. We're watching for Rick to come around, trying to maintain a constant speed, maintaining the performance of the race car. And as soon as Roger radios to Rick what the results of that last lap, we'll have a chance to talk to Roger and find out what their strategy is from here and whether or not they got a shot. How about it, Roger? Any chance to catch the leaders?
Well, we weren't really up at the front there on that restart, and part of that's what caught Bobby Rahal getting in the middle of that traffic. We're sitting third. It's a points race, so we got to take what we can get. I don't know what's going to happen up there, but with 8 or 9 laps to go, I think we've got to be pretty happy where we are.
So at this point, a third would be good for today, particularly considering the conditions, eh?
Well, it'd be great for us. We just want to finish both cars.
Okay, Danny Sullivan continues to run out there also, although Danny in that early race shunt, remember, lost the lap, which he has never been able to make up. Despite the overall yellow flag, he never made up that lap that he lost.
One of the things, Johnny Rutherford, that we were alluding to before the interview with Roger Penske is that Rick Mears for many years has been touted solely as an oval track expert. And what people forget is a lot of that was accounted for the fact that when he crashed so badly at Montreal, we really didn't have as many road races as we have now. So that his learning curve wasn't as strong because his feet were hurting for so long. But in talking to Rick Mears this year, he said, look, I want to prove to people that I'm equally adept at road racing as I am at oval track racing. And now that he's fully healed, it seems to be coming to the front that he is indeed one of the better road racers.
Well, yes. Rick has always, in my estimation, been an excellent road racer. He had the misfortune of the accident in Canada that just nearly crushed both feet. He's had a long recovery period. I think he's just now getting fit to where he can do the job and drive the car.
Well, I'll tell you one great thing about Rick Mears, too. He took delivery last week of a brand new 47-foot fishing boat. And he was telling me before the start of the race that with that new Sea Ray that he's kind of tried to get his mind back to racing after he and Roger and the rest of the crew down there in Bakersfield took it out for 3 days and just went fishing.
Sure, that's not a distraction.
You never know. I guess, you know, everybody has to have a little bit of a hobby. And many people have said Rick Mears' only hobby until that word about the boat was his auto racing. So, who knows?
He's a racer.
Boy, that's an understatement. This is a racer as well, ladies and gentlemen. Emerson Fittipaldi, who, in my mind, made what has to be one of the most brilliant and excellent moves that I have seen in road racing and IndyCar competition in many a year, as he took the lead away from Mario Andretti several laps to go. You know, for Emerson, until this race, he'd never led a lap here. And now look what he's doing. So for Fittipaldi, certainly the learning curve has gotten better, even if he never led a lap.
You know, like this year, the Marlboro Lola is a 1987 car. And after the first thing here, we feel like we don't have enough downforce in the car. I was very fast down on the straight. Compared to Danny, I follow Danny. But on the downhill corners where the car gets very light, I don't have traction, I don't have grip.
He's got plenty of traction and grip this afternoon, though. And I wonder, was the rain a blessing maybe in disguise for them while they're hunting for the right setup?
Well, it could well have been because they have an excellent rain setup, but the car has been convertible, you know, and here we see him making very short work of traffic. You know, he just comes up, and if the guy gives him any courtesy at all, he's able to blast right by. And so the car is optimum. He's been working extremely well in the dry and extremely well in the wet. So the car's got to be perfect.
The next man to be dispensed with will be Ed Pym in car number 33. And Emerson Fittipaldi is showing people the fast way around here at Mid-Ohio Racetrack as he continues to lead the Escort Radar Warning 200. But Andretti's right behind him with Mears, Unser Jr., Sullivan, and Bozell. By Monroe Shock Absorbers, for shocks and struts, America rides Monroe. And by Gates, a trusted name in automotive products for over 75 years. Well, with apologies to Willie Nelson and his buddy Holmes, the laps are dwindling down to a precious few here. Only five to go for this man, Emerson Fittipaldi. Now, believe it or not, Johnny, he's only finished four of the 10 previous races run in 1988. So when we talk about momentum, this could be a boost for this team as well.
He's made up for it here today, I can assure you. He's led nearly every lap, and he's the car's working exceptionally well. When you can take a car and make it work in the dry like that and in the wet, well, that's the sign the team's got a handle on the situation, and he is doing a marvelous job leading this race, having made that textbook pass earlier on Mario Andretti taking the lead back, so he's having a fine day.
His last road racing victory was back in 1987 at Toronto, his last oval win in 1985 at the Michigan 500, but this man today has impressed everyone. Not only the pass, but the fact that he did it with one of the toughest competitors, a guy that knows how to use the mirrors, knows how to use the throttle, and in a very difficult portion of this racetrack, Mario Andretti, you know, he's like a lot like Bobby Allison. You have to really work to get by Andretti.
That's right, and of course, the fact that they're both world champions of past, you know, that says a lot. They're both heads-up drivers.
Knowing a man like Mario Andretti, how appreciative after it's all said and done will he be of the past?
He will acknowledge the fact that he was put upon down there by a master, I'm sure, because Emerson just did it like you're supposed to.
Not to be redundant, but it certainly was reminiscent of a Rembrandt standing at an easel, the way Emerson Fittipaldi took the lead away from Mario Andretti. Now, there is Al Unser Jr. Now, he has begun to lengthen his distance, although he's one lap down to Emerson Fittipaldi, over his rival, Danny Sullivan. That battle has gone away as well, but this will be for naught for the Valvoline entry, because despite the fact that he is directly behind the leader and being shown in the fourth position, the way things are going now, unofficial reports would put Danny Sullivan at the top of the points chain. Here's Unser being shown in fourth place, and he's really bringing that car out quite well.
Al Unser Jr. has been standing on the gas, as they say. He's closed up to a very close distance behind Emerson Fittipaldi, but it's, I'm afraid, going to be for naught. He would like to get back in the lead lap, and that's the way you do it on an oval. Road course, you'd have to have a full course yellow so he could take advantage of a caution. We're down to the very last laps, and he's just pushing. I'm sure he's showing that he can do that job.
Remember at the beginning of the show, we talked about parity. We talked about the domination of the Chevrolet. Four men running Chevrolets accounted for the victories in the first nine races, and of course, Ray Hall's win in the Judd. Al Unser Jr. was the last man to be victorious driving a Chevrolet. Emerson Fittipaldi is the only Chevrolet team driver that has yet to score a victory. So it could be 5-5 for Chevrolet and 1 for Judd. If Fittipaldi can hold on to the remaining two laps and score his first victory of 1988.
This is where we're getting down, Jackie, to that situation that he had back in the pits a little bit earlier today on his last pit stop. Whether or not he, in fact, did get enough fuel in the car to go the distance. It's going to show up here any minute if he's having a problem.
Now, is there anything that you as a driver can do, you know, to maybe try and ensure that you have a little bit more fuel than under normal circumstances? He certainly is no longer feeling the hot breath of Mario Andretti. I'm sure he knows that Al Unser Jr. is a lap down to him. You know, can he save the car a little bit?
Yes, he can start short shifting the car, not running it up in the RPM to where it uses the amount of fuel. And the best thing I think for him to do right now would be to pull over and let little Al get by and just kind of coast to the finish with these few laps left.
Emerson Fittipaldi from Brazil calls Miami his home. We talked about his boat business. He has a booming automotive business as well, manufacturing accessories. And Al Unser Jr. really chomping at the bit, as they say, trying to get around Mario Andretti. And, you know, shades of Meadowlands as well. Now, that was a battle for the lead, but I'm sure that Emerson has got to be thinking about that as well and saying, maybe I ought to let him go by, especially as they begin to round out of the keyhole and go to race traffic. But there, now we see the reason why Unser Jr. is trying to get around Emerson Fittipaldi. It's because of this man, Danny Sullivan. Where did he come from?
Well, he didn't fall out of an airplane and just land there. I can assure you he has moved and used the muscle of that Chevrolet and pulled into position.
And listen to this. That last lap, Danny Sullivan turned 109 miles. lap. By 2 miles per hour, the fastest lap of the race.
How about that? Well, he's on the move, and of course he wants to get up there and challenge for this position with Al Unser Jr. Emerson's just sitting there waiting for the checkered flag virtually, and hopefully he'll be able to stay out of trouble, not have any problems, and we'll see what happens here in a few minutes.
So Danny Sullivan all over the back deck lid of the Valvoline car from the Rick Gallus stable, being piloted by Al Unser Jr. In the meantime, Emerson Fittipaldi, not being challenged for position, but being challenged by fuel consumption, continues out of turn number 15 and takes the checkered flag. He is the winner of the race today. Sullivan will have to settle for fifth position, Unser Jr. fourth, Rick Mears hangs on for third, and Mario Andretti will take second. What a great win for Emerson Fittipaldi. As we said, his last road course win was in 1987, his last oval win in 1985, but this afternoon, after going into this race, never having led a lap in the Escort Radar Warning Detector 200, he not only leads, but he wins that race here in 1988. And he is, in our opinion, the Goodyear Eagle driver of the race. Emerson Fittipaldi. So Goodyear will be sending a check for $1,000 in his name to Kara. It will be from a very good driver to a very good cause. And that's a good pick.
Yes, I think so. Emerson did a marvelous job. Showed his prowess in the wet and the dry, and the team did a marvelous effort putting the car together, making it work that well for him, and he's happy, waving at everybody, and that's the cool-off lap when you've taken the checkered is, it's a shot of adrenaline.
For Emerson Fittipaldi, that thumbs-up signal is always indicative of true happiness for that Latin-bred individual with the long hair that, hey, boy, I tell you, I'd like to be in as good a shape at his age when I'm his age, and, his spirit has been rekindled as he takes the congratulations of those around him, and the crowd has been very appreciative of this run here today as well. And a great run for Pat Patrick, Chip Ganassi, and the rest of the Patrick Racing stable. This is a well-needed and much-deserved win for them. So Fittipaldi comes home victorious here in Mid-Ohio to score his first victory. Andretti second, Mears third, Unser Jr. fourth.
How can you improve something this great?
So the Escort 200 is history. Emerson Fittipaldi comes home victorious for the first time in 1988, followed by Mario Andretti. A fine run to third for Rick Mears. Al Unser Jr., although a lap down, comes home in fourth. Also a lap down is Danny Sullivan. The winner's circle interview today is brought to you by Goodyear Tires. Goodyear, because there really is a difference. Let's go to Goodyear winner's circle now and Gary Lee. Gary?
Well, it's Larry Newbert out here, Jack. Gary's had a mic problem, but we are standing by with a man who had no problems today, Emerson Fittipaldi, despite the rain. And finally, you got that win here in 1988.
I know, Larry. I'm very pleased. My Marlboro Lola was behaving really well the whole race. And the toughest part was trying to pass Mario at the end of the race.
Also, you got a great start because we started on wet conditions, and you were ready to go when the green light came on.
Yeah, I did a good start, and the team made incredible work in the pits. We were fast in the pits, we were fast in the track. I'm very pleased.
And late in the race, you came out of the pits after the final pit stop behind Mario, and you got him. Was that one of your more classic passes as an IndyCar driver?
I knew it was going to be very difficult to pass Mario, and Mario was holding the position really well. And then he went to the inside at the end of the straight, and I tried on the outside, and I managed, and it was just it happened.
Jack, this is Emil's first win of 1988, but I guarantee you, it's not his last IndyCar victory.
Well, that must say it all right there. That picture there and the man that finished in second, Mario Andretti. There'll be another day for Andretti and his team. They ran well, too. We'll be back to wrap up the rest of the activities here at the Escort Radar Warning Detector 200. But first, we've got to break away for these messages. Well, the dust, as they say, is settled, and here's the final order of finish. The top 10 in the Escort 200 for 1988. Emerson Fittipaldi comes home victorious, his first of the year. Mario Andretti in second. Rick Mears, a steady run to go home in third position. Al Unser Jr. and Danny Sullivan round out the top five after going a lap down during an early race spin. In sixth finishing position is Raul Boisel and Johnny Rutherford. That's a good run for that job.
Creditable run for Raul. He came from dead last because of problems that they had in qualifying and in practice. And moved up to sixth spot. So Raul did a marvelous job today.
Excellent call. Should go down as well for your seventh place finisher, John Jones, that rookie that is chasing that title. Deo Fabi puts the Porsche in eighth finishing position. Derek Daly finishes in ninth. And a man we didn't talk too much about this weekend, but he's done a great job, Didier Tays. A good future in kart racing ahead of that young man. He finishes in 10th. Now, what does this race do to the point standings? Well, there you have it. Danny Sullivan now goes back to the lead, followed by Alan Sir Jr., Bobby Rahal, Rick Mears, and Mario Andretti. In sixth position, a tie for sixth, is Raul Boisel and Emerson Fittipaldi. Michael Andretti holds on to the eighth position, ninth to John Jones and Derek Daly in 10th in the national championship chase. Now, next weekend, we'll be at another road racing course, a little bit longer than this one, the Road America Briggs & Stratton 200 from Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. You'll be seeing all the action at 3:30 p.m. Eastern Time. That's next Sunday. And if this is any indication of what we're going to see next week, you'd better stay tuned, because it's going to be a real barn burner. So, seems appropriate that the rains have subsided. It's clear. The victory goes for the first time this year to Emerson Fittipaldi, his Pat Patrick Ganassi team very happy in victory lane. For Johnny Rutherford, Larry Newberg, Gary Lee, I'm Jack Arute saying Happy Labor Day. We'll see you next week at Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. So long.